Hi everyone, my name is Nick, and today I'm going to spotlight some houseplants that thrive in low-light situations. So these are perfect for anybody who's working with a north or east-facing window, as those are the directions that provide the least amount of sunlight. And before we get started, I do feel the need to reiterate the point that low-light does not equal no light. So these plants do require sunlight in order to survive, it's just that they don't need that much of it. In fact, I find that all of these thrive in settings that have limited sunlight. If you are looking for houseplants for no light, you might be out of luck. You can always get a grow light. In fact, you can grow pretty much anything with a grow light. However, I might have one example that just might work for you, so stay tuned. The first plant I want to talk about today that thrives in low light is actually a group of plants, a really wonderful group of plants, which is commonly referred to as Chinese evergreen. Their scientific name is Aglaonema, and this one right here is an Aglaonema chocolate. And this is kind of a newer one on the market. It's definitely a little bit more of a harder one to find one, but I really wanted to highlight this one today because of its affinity to a very popular houseplant that is Calathea ornata, or the pinstripe Calathea, which will not be on this list today, which for good reason. I know if you walk into many houseplant stores and that's there, I know some of the workers might recommend that houseplant for you if you are looking for a low-light houseplant, but that is not a good one. It's going to die in like a week or two. It's just going to look beautiful before it starts to look like crap. But this one looks pretty much exactly like that plant, and I've had this thing for almost a year now, and I'd say it looks picture perfect. The only thing about Aglaonemas is you'll normally buy them as a little bush, and over time as they grow upright, they will lose some of their leaves on the bottom and they will become a little caney, as you can see here, but I just think it gives that plant a little bit more added character, so I don't really mind it at all. In fact, if it gets too tall and caney, you can just go ahead and cut it back. If you look closely, hopefully you can see, I don't know how well you can see, but there are these little nubs right above the ridges that are all along the stem here, and that is where a new plant would emerge, or a new stem would emerge if you were to cut this back and then submerge the top here in water. If you do care for this plant correctly, in due time it will regrow a new plant, so you can cut it back to wherever you like if you get tired of it looking kind of caney and stemmy. But like I said, I kind of appreciate that. But my favorite thing about Aglaonema is the sheer variety that it carries. So this one right here, like I said, is a little bit more of an interesting variety. I don't think it's probably getting the namesake Chinese evergreen along too well with all these colors, but there are just so many different colors and varieties of Aglaonema. There are plain green ones, there are ones that have white in the leaves, pink in the leaves, red in the leaves. There's so many different varieties. A little green one that I have to share with you guys today is this Aglaonema, I think it's Silver Queen, and this is an example of one that I had grown out from a cutting. I had a plant forever ago that I think I like annihilated or something, or I think my roommate's cat got into it a long time ago. I don't know what happened, but I ended up having to salvage it, and I just had this one piece of it left, and I think this is just such an adorable little example of this plant. So you can see between these two right here how many different colors are going on, but like I said, it really doesn't stop there. But one of my favorite things about these plants too, not only the sheer variety, is of course how easy they are to care for. There's a reason why I have so many of these around my home. They really don't require that much sunlight at all. There are, like I said, some varieties that have like white and like bright pinks in the leaves, and those might require a little bit more sunlight than the ones I'm sharing today. However, they would still completely thrive in a north or east facing window. You might just want to keep them in a close proximity to those windows, but this green one here, the Silver Queen, or this chocolate are ones that I grow in some of the darkest corners in my home, and they are absolutely thriving, as you can see. I think they look amazing. Like I said, you buy them looking very bushy, and I find with practically every Aglaonema that I bring home, once it leaves those perfect greenhouse settings, that some of the lower leaves, maybe like two or three at a time, will turn yellow and fall off soon after bringing it home, like maybe within the first month. But after that, it seems to have acclimated to my home and grow at a steady rate where maybe it's only having one leaf at a maximum of a time turning yellow and falling off. So if you have recently gotten an Aglaonema and some of the lower leaves are starting to turn yellow or brown or crisp up, I wouldn't be too alarmed, but if you've had it for a long time, you might need to assess what's going on. So these plants, because they're low light house plants, really don't require that much attention or watering. I'm probably watering both of these, like I'd say no more than every 10 days, probably around every 2 weeks. And of course, like this is one tiny little plant in a pot here, a small plant versus this is a couple plants, a little bit of a bigger planter. So I'm sure I'm not watering these on this same exact schedule, but it's best to be hands-off with your Aglaonema. In fact, if you go too far off with watering them, they will wilt quite a bit and they do perk back up quite easily. But I wouldn't go too far along on forgetting them, because that's when you're probably going to have a couple more leaves turn yellow and fall off, as they don't love the inconsistency of the watering. They just tolerate a little bit better than some other houseplants. Another example of a low-light houseplant is this kangaroo paw fern right here. So I absolutely have a place in my heart for ferns. However, I'm sure I've openly spoke here on YouTube about how I'm not like the biggest fan of their behavior. There are a lot of ferns out there that are very, very finicky, very fussy, and are very quick to die on you. However, this kangaroo paw fern is fortunately a great example of ferns that don't behave like that. So this is a much hardier fern than, say, like a Boston fern or a button fern or a heart fern, maidenhair fern. All of those ferns are very, very thin and frilly, and they're very quick to die if you forget about them for just a little bit. But this is a much hardier ones in terms of handling drought. And there are a couple other types of ferns that are very hardy as well. This is just one of my favorite ones that I wanted to point out today, which is perfect for lower light conditions. But many of the ferns that have these kind of like creepy crawly legs, mine isn't really walking yet, it's still kind of crawling, but you can see some of them sticking out here. They're these little like stems that kind of crawl along the surface of the pot, and that's where the fronds are emerging from. And because of this, I feel like the plant just holds on to water much better. I don't understand the science behind it. I probably should have done some research on it, but any of the plants that you find like that, that have these little crawling legs along the pot, they usually handle drought much better. So example is like the rabbit's foot fern, or an Aglaomorpha, or a blue star fern, which is also one of my favorites, although that one kind of requires a little bit more sunlight than all the other ones I'm talking about today. But I just absolutely love the look of these plants. It's kind of hard for me to not fill my home with ferns, but I also know if I did that, I would have like 100 dead plants on my hands. But I feel confident when I bring home kangaroo paw ferns that they're gonna do much better. In fact, you can see these couple of newer fronds right here and just how beautiful and large they are. And they're really just giving me this like bohemian jungle vibe that I'm absolutely striving for. This type of fern, I do find this, you know, kangaroo paw and like the rabbit's foot, I do find they're a little bit more susceptible to brown scale. I actually was just cleaning off a couple of leaves of it. They kind of hang out like along the like the ridge stem. I don't know what it is. It's like the main part of the leaf that has like the thick vein stem. They'll kind of hang out along there as well as along the stem, the petiole. I'm really lacking on my plant vocabulary today, but I would just be wary about the brown scale if you are growing these. However, the good thing about brown scale is it really isn't going to kill your plant. It's just going to exist. I can see a leaf right here. I don't know how well it's going to show up, but you can kind of look along the midrib. I don't know the plant vocabulary, but along the rib here, it's got some brown scale hanging out. But I just take a little cotton swab or a paper towel with a little bit of rubbing alcohol in it, and I just rub it off, and that's how I take care of it, and it works really well. In comparison to the Aglaonema and probably many of the other houseplants I'm gonna talk about today, these do require a little bit more water, but like I said, they are very drought tolerant. You just can't treat it like you would treat the Aglaonema and not water it for 2 weeks, because you'll probably have a couple of these leaves turn brown and crisp up, but it's not going to be the whole plant. It's just gonna be one or two leaves, and maybe the leaves will kind of become a little bit more pale and limp. But once you go ahead and water it, I find that these perk right back up. So a really excellent option if you want that fern bohemian vibe in your home, but maybe you've struggled with the Boston ferns and the maidenhair ferns, this is the next step for you. The next one we're gonna talk about today, number 3, is going to be this ZZ plant, or Zamioculcas zamiifolia. And I feel like out of all the houseplants I'm talking about today, this is probably going to be the most classic, over-talked about low-light houseplant. And that's for good reason. This is the one that I hinted at the beginning of this video that is the only possible option for you if you are looking for a houseplant for an area that receives no light, or like very, very extremely little low light that you just don't think anything else can grow there, and you would normally get a fake plant for it. I would argue that a ZZ plant is worth trying out in that space. My tip for growing ZZ plants in situations where they are receiving very little to no light is that if you water this more than you pay your rent, it's too much. So you can just kind of think about that every time you pay your rent. Just go ahead and give this plant a little drink of water, and that's really the relationship that you can share with this plant and not paying any mind to it whatsoever, other than that, which I think is a really fantastic symbiotic relationship. That being said, I always kind of am wary about giving this to people back when I worked at the plant store, if they were buying a gift for somebody who was new to houseplants, because as easy as this thing sounds, somebody who is new to houseplants is going to want to nurture their plants unless they're just like a super on-the-go person and they don't even want houseplants and you're trying to get them to grow houseplants and they just don't want it at all, then maybe this is the option. But if this is for a beginner gardener, you better make sure that they know not to water this more than like every 2 weeks, because this thing is going to rot very quickly. The reason why this thing handles drought so well is that they look like little potatoes that are growing inside of the root system, and they're called tubers or rhizomes, and they store a lot of the water and the energy that this plant requires in order to grow, and that's where all of these little fronds are actually emerging from. And because these are so bulbous and full of water, if this plant is overwatered, they are very, very quick to rot, and it's kind of gross. I would recommend avoiding it, so it's best to just be hands off with these, but the lower light you're giving it, the less you can pay attention to it, and that's what I love about it. Of course, if you are really starving these of their sunlight, they are going to grow in a little bit more wimpy. You can see that the fronds that mine's putting off and the low light conditions that I'm giving it aren't necessarily the most enticing, but I still think this is getting the point across as a nice green plant that you can grow in some of the darkest corners of your home. In my old apartment, I grew this in our built-in shelves, which did not receive a lick of sunlight. Now that it's in my new home, it's getting a little bit more sunlight, but still, I am absolutely giving it very, very low light in comparison to any of the other houseplants that I have in my home, and I still think it looks fantastic. There are a couple brown tips from when I had it on a table at the old apartment, and my roommate's cat took a couple nibbles out of it, but I moved it quick after that to save its appearance, because this is such a slow-growing houseplant. If the leaves do get damaged, they're not going to grow back very quick at all. It's going to look the same way for a very, very long time, so you better be happy with the way it looks when you purchase it. And I don't normally feel that way about a lot of plants. People would always be so like indecisive about the houseplant that they wanted to purchase back when I worked at the plant store. Like, they'd want the most perfect-looking one, and I would have to remind them, like, none of my houseplants look the same as when I purchased them, like, even within a month or two after I had them. However, I think a ZZ plant and also a snake plant, which I'm not going to be talking about in today's video, are ones that you probably want to purchase looking as perfect as possible. Next up, I have this little underrated cutie right here, and this is a Pellionia pulchra. I've seen a couple different names for this houseplant, but that's what I'm going to call it in today's video, and I'm sure that would pop up if you Google it. But this is a really fun little creeping houseplant, and this is one that I don't often see when I'm at houseplant stores. I feel like sometimes I see them in hanging baskets every now and again, but I'll normally find this in the terrarium section of the store, sold in very, very small pots. And I just don't think that does this plant any justice, because you can see how beautiful this looks. It's just like a just spilling over the side of the pot mess right here. So Pellionias are, I believe they're very closely related to Pileas, if you're familiar. So they do kind of have a similar appearance, but they're much more of a trailing houseplant in comparison. And I'm sure you can kind of use your imagination of this growing in the wild, just crawling over the forest floor and creeping over rocks and roots and anything in its way. It really is an excellent ground cover houseplant that translates to it being a really excellent trailing plant. This is, like I said, often used in terrarium growing, and this is a really perfect one if you are growing anything inside an enclosure, as this does prefer a little bit more humidity, but fortunately it also doesn't require that much sunlight at all. The only thing about this one in comparison to all the other houseplants I feel like I'm talking about today is that this one does require, or I guess more along the lines of the fern, this one does require a little bit more attention. While you can put this in the much darker corners of your home, if you forget about this because it's in a dark corner of your home, you might one day just find a shriveled up mess. I've learned the hard way. I've killed like 3 of these in the past, but I do know the potential that they have, so I'm always willing to get another one, because it's my fault. I'm always the one forgetting about them, but they have never done anything wrong to me other than exist and just look absolutely gorgeous. Do these perform better in terrarium settings? Absolutely. In fact, if you got like a glass cloche for this, if you needed something like on a shelf in a low light scenario, I think this would absolutely thrive in that situation, so definitely something to keep in mind there. I just have this one growing on my kitchen counter in my apartment, which once again is one of the lower light areas in my home, and I think it looks absolutely fantastic. This is new for me. You might remember I've only had this one for like a month now, which is not long at all, but like I said, I do have some experience growing this in the past, and I've grown it in plenty of terrariums. It really is just such an excellent low light houseplant, and it really has a lot of character that you don't see in many other houseplants, like this kind of like iridescent foliage that has like not a lick of green on it at all. It's just like rust color and like silvers. There's so many, I guess there's a little bit of green on it, but it's mostly just a bunch of other different colors that you don't see in houseplants, which is another reason why it performs so well in a terrarium, because it is very eye-catching. And just another reason why this houseplant is so overrated and why you should be growing it in your home. So if you do stumble upon a nice little pot of Pellionia pulchra, Pellionia repens, whatever you see it called, I highly recommend it. And there are a couple different ones that are on the market. There are ones that have a little bit more green in the leaves. There is one that is completely green and it's just an absolutely beautiful plant, the Pellionia argentia, I think it's called. So there's a couple other Pellionias out there for you, but any of them are perfect. They're all underrated houseplants, and I think all of them should be getting a little more attention, because if you can see from this beautiful houseplant right here and how gorgeous it just looks in this pot, they deserve it. And let's see, I have two more houseplants to talk about today. I have six in total. So let's talk about this one, which I talk about a lot here on YouTube, but once again, that's for good reason, because this is just such an excellent houseplant. So this is Scindapsus pictus. This one in particular is a Scindapsus pictus exotica, the larger leaf Scindapsus. Also, the slower growing Scindapsus of many of the other ones that are on the market. Any Scindapsus will do for your low light scenarios. There's the smaller leaved ones, the argyrius, which grows much faster. There's the jade satin with the all green leaves. There's plenty of different varieties that have been popping up on the market, but I would also lump in many of the epipranums as well. So like the epipranum aureums, all of those varieties, and the epipranum pinnatum, Cebu blue. So any of these like trailing pothos plants, you know, this is sometimes called a pothos. Those are going to be lumped in today's category, but I'm only going to be showing you guys this Scindapsus pictus today, because this is the one that has really been my tried and true for me over the years. This particular Scindapsus I got as like the first plant that I purchased back when I got my job at the houseplant store. So I've had it for about 3 years now, and it's just been absolutely thriving for me. When you buy these, if you're buying it in a 4-inch pot, it's typically just a couple of leaves that are just inside a little pot, and they are very slow growing to get started. That is if you are purchasing this one right here. The other ones, Golden Pothos, Scindapsus argyrius, those ones grow like a mile a day. This one's just a much slower one, so this is perfect if you are looking for a plant to stay a little bit more contained. And it's definitely a little bit more about the foliage with this one, while the other ones is kind of just about the sheer volume that they grow in, which of course is very exciting as well. But this one just kind of gets the job done for me. I grow this one up on a shelf. I've been growing it up on a shelf for a long time. Obviously, it's a different shelf now that I'm in a new home, but it's really just been the perfect one for me to just grow up high and see these beautiful vines that grow ever so slowly work their way down. You can see I have probably about 3 feet of vines on this plant right here, and like I said, I've had this one for about 3 years now. And they are very, very slow growing at first. This one definitely follows that adage I always say, the first year they sleep, the second year they creep, the third year they leap. This guy's finally getting leaping now, but it's still a little underwhelming in comparison to the smaller leaf Scindapsus and the Golden Pothos that, like I said, literally grow a mile a day. So one of the things I love most about Scindapsus is their language. It's a very good houseplant to learn how to speak houseplant, if you will. These leaves are shingling leaves, so they'll grow up flat along surfaces in the forest, like tree trunks and stuff like that. So you can kind of see that in the leaves. So when they require water, they go from being this flat leaf to completely like curling in on the edges, and you'll just find your plant completely curled up, and you go ahead and water it, and this thing just opens back up and it looks good as new. There's a threshold there. You can go a couple days, probably just, you know, 1 or 2 days too long without watering this houseplant, and I'm sure a couple of these leaves will turn yellow from inconsistent watering. So do be mindful there, but it's just perfect to have this plant up on a shelf and you can see the day it needs water, those leaves curl up, you go ahead and give it a drink and it looks good as new within a couple hours to the next day. So I just really enjoy the language that this plant shares, as well as it will tell you if you're watering it too much. I would just wait for the leaf curl myself. I think it's the surefire way to make sure you're going to water this plant correctly. Like I said, you can't let it stay curled for a couple days at a time. But if you are watering this plant too much, some of these leaves from the lower parts of the vine, or the oldest parts of the vine, they will start to turn yellow and fall off, and that's its way of saying, hey, I'm receiving too much water. If it's just one at a time, sometimes it's just the leaf turns yellow and falls off because of age, but usually it's induced from, like I said, inconsistent watering or overwatering. So you can be a little mindful there, but like I said, this is just a really excellent example of a houseplant to use to learn how to care for houseplants. This is really the one that I think speaks the most to you. The Golden Pothos and the Cebu Pothos, they also have very good language too. I just think this one is the one that goes the most volumes to tell you what it needs. So a really excellent houseplant for lower light scenarios. I would also be mindful though, that if a plant is overwatered, like deathly overwatered, like root rot situations, it will react the same way as it does when it's underwatered. So if you're at like a houseplant store, and I've seen this before, that the plants are well watered, but the leaves are like super curled up, it's probably that they weren't well rooted enough to begin with. So I would probably just not go ahead and purchase that houseplant and bring it home, but you can kind of use your best judgment there. To tell, you know, how the soil's looking versus how the plants feel if you give them a little tug in the pot. Oh, don't be too aggressive in the houseplant stores. You don't want to be ruining their houseplants, but just a couple tips there. I have seen these overwatered or probably mistaken for thinking that they're underwatered and then they're just getting like super hella overwatered and it's an absolute death sentence. So just be mindful there. And I have one more to talk about today. This is a bromeliad. So I would say that many bromeliads fall into this low light selection. This one in particular is, let's check the tag, I kind of forget. This is a Neorogelia Zoe. Oh, almost hit myself in the eye there. And this bromeliad I actually appreciate, speaking of it hitting me in the eye, because it's a little bit more smoother at the edges. There is a little bit of spikiness, but many bromeliads are known for being like scarily spiky around the edges. So do be mindful there. Don't get them too close to your eyes. Or you gotta be mindful too when you're working with them. There were plenty of bromeliads I used to get in when I worked at the store where you would go into like clip off one brown leaf and you would come back with a couple little bloody scratches on your arm. So you really kind of be careful when dealing with these. But like I said, this one right here, I appreciate because of its lack of spikes, or they're at least very, very small that I don't think they would do any damage to me, but be careful. People grow bromeliads for many different reasons. I'm growing this one right here for its foliage because I really, really like the stripes that it gets, but people often grow bromeliads for their flowers, or at least they're sold that way for their blooms. You'll probably see like the plain green leaved bromeliads in pretty much all houseplant stores or grocery stores, hardware stores that have that kind of flower spike coming out the top that looks in many different shapes and colors and sizes. So there is a lot to love about these, but I prefer the ones that are grown for the foliage because the ones that have pretty neat foliage have like really, really neat foliage. And I think this is probably like the worst example of a bromeliad with neat foliage because there are some that have like absolutely enigmatic foliage that is just too good to pass up on. But I just don't have the room in my home, so I only have this one bromeliad here that I've only gotten probably in like the last year. But it's just perfect for me to throw in a lower light corner of my home. I go ahead and give it water like once a week and it's good to go. In fact, this one, I literally just throw it in the shower or either turn the shower on or I'll use my watering can depending on how many plants I have in the shower. And I will give it a good drink to clean the dust off the leaves that you can probably see needs a good dusting right now. And more importantly, so that the little cup, the inside of the plant, I don't know what it's called, fills up with water. This plant likes to have water inside the crown. Is that what it's called? The crown of this plant. And do I know why? No. Should I have done my research? Yes, I should have. But I just know that you put water inside your Neorogelias and some of your other bromeliads. I don't think all bromeliads require that water inside the crown, but many of them do. So I would just do research on the ones that you're bringing home. But it's just such an underrated houseplant for that reason that I think so many are sold just for their green leaves and their inflorescences that actually die. And then after they die, the plant itself starts dying. But the good thing about that is that when the plant is dying, it actually puts all of its energy into pushing off pups. So you can see right here, this plant right here, it probably bloomed sometime in the last year or two, or however many, I don't know how long the whole life cycle is. Once again, should have done my research. This is a pup right here that you can see is coming out, as well as this one right here that is much younger and having a harder time developing for me in my home in comparison to this one. But these are basically sucking all the energy out of these mother plants. So it's a very slow death. It's very graceful. It's not like it blooms and it dies. So you don't have to be concerned about that. And this goes for air plants as well, which are also in the Bromeliad family, Bromeliaceae, which is pretty cool. Although a lot of air plants do require a little more sunlight in comparison to bromeliads, because I don't know, their leaves are just more silvery and they require more sunlight. I'm really lacking on my research in this section of the video, I apologize. But yeah, bromeliads, super cool. Check out your bromeliad section at your store or online and you might be surprised at what you see, especially if you're only used to seeing the ones that just have plain green foliage. So there might be a world out there that your eyes haven't even been opened to, but do be mindful of the spikes, especially if you have pets or children. Those spikes can literally be worse than cacti spikes in some situations, and you guys know I'm not a big fan of cacti for that reason alone. So that's it for today's video. Low light houseplants, houseplants that thrive in low light situations. Like I said, none of these can thrive or grow really whatsoever in no light situations unless you had a grow light. However, I would say the ZZ plant is worth trying. Just like I said, do not water it more than you pay your rent. Less is more in those situations. If you don't already, follow me on Instagram at @PhillyFoliage, subscribe to my channel, and I will see you guys in my next video. But before we go, for the real ones of you who are still sticking around, I want to do a Q&A video soon. I haven't done one in a very, very long time, and I think it'd be fun to sit down and repot some plants or something and give you guys some of my insight. So if you would like to leave a question for that, you can leave it in the comment section below by just typing like QA --, something to catch my attention to make sure I know it's for the Q&A and not just a random question. Also, please, please do me a huge favor and don't leave like troubleshooting questions like my philodendron is turning yellow or something like that. Like, I want to do like more insightful ones. Another time we'll do like a plant doctoring troubleshooting thing to give you guys insight on that, but I don't want to answer those kind of questions for this video. So let's leave it to some things more fun, you know what I'm saying? So just do me that favor, do it for yourself as well. Hopefully that's not too selfish of me, but like I said, we'll do another one some other time. So thank you guys again for joining me. Have a great day.